Good morning, children, and welcome back to the digital classroom of Vikram Juneja. In my previous video, I did the first half of the short story, A Horse and Two Goats by R.K. Narayan. In this video of mine, I'll be continuing with the same story and we'll finish the reading and the explanation of the story. Children, please open on page number 61 of your book, Treasure Trove, a collection of ICSE poems and short stories. We are going to read from where we had left in our last video. The old man now understood the reference to the horse, thought for a second, and said in his own language, "I was an urchin this high when I heard my grandfather explain this horse and warrior, and my grandfather himself was this high when he heard his grandfather, whose grandfather?" At this, the other man interrupted him. "I don't want to seem to have stopped here for nothing. I'll offer you a good price for this," he said, indicating the horse. He had concluded without the least doubt that Muni owned this mud horse. Perhaps he guessed by the way he sat on its pedestal, like other souvenir sellers in this country presiding over their wares. Muni followed the man's eyes and pointing fingers and dimly understood the subject matter and feeling relieved that the theme of the mutilated body had been abandoned, at least for the time being, said again enthusiastically, "I was this high when my grandfather told me about this horse and the warrior, and my grandfather was this high when he himself." The Tamil that Muni spoke was stimulating, even as pure sound, and the foreigner listened with fascination. "I wish I had my tape recorder here," he said, assuming the pleasantest expression. "Your language sounds wonderful. I get a kick out of every word you utter here," he indicated his ears. "But you don't have to waste your breath in sales talk. I appreciate this article. You don't have to explain its points." Now, children, through his gestures, the old man was at least able to make out that there was this reference to the horse made by the foreigner. He thought for a second and he started in his own language. He said that when he was a poor little boy, that high, he actually pointed towards some length he was, when he heard his grandfather explain the horse and the warrior, and his grandfather himself was that high when he heard his grandfather. At this, the other man, that's the foreigner, he interrupted him. He says that, "I don't want to seem to have stopped here for nothing. I'll offer you a good price." So he's basically talking about the old man to sell his horse, because he thinks he has concluded all by himself that Muni owned that horse. Probably that was because the way he was sitting on the pedestal of the horse, like other souvenir sellers in the country, they sit on their wares and they sell their wares. So Muni was trying to follow the man's eyes and the pointing fingers, and he dimly understood. And he realized this thing, that the topic of the mutilated body had been abandoned by the foreigner. So he felt very enthusiastic and he started talking about the horse. He said, "I was this high again." Again, he started repeating that my grandfather told me about the horse and the warrior, and his grandfather was that high when he told him about the horse and the warrior. The Tamil which the old man was speaking was so fascinating that the foreigner wished that he had the tape recorder. He said, "I'm fascinated by the way you're speaking." So he says, "I get a kick when you speak every word." Okay, he indicated his ears and he said that you don't have to waste your time in arguing, because the foreigner was thinking that this man is wasting his time in describing about the horse and his the warrior. So he said, "You don't have to explain its points to me. I am ready to buy this horse because I like this article." Read further. "I never went to a school in those days. Only Brahmins went to school, but we had to go out and work in the fields morning till night, from sowing to harvest time. And when Pongal came and we had cut the harvest, my father allowed me to go out and play with others at the tank. And so I don't know the Parangi language you speak. Even little fellow in your country probably speak the Parangi language, but here only learned men and officers know it." The foreigner laughed heartily, took out another cigarette and offered it to Muni, who now smoked with ease, deciding to stay on if the fellow was going to be so good as to keep up his cigarette supply. The American now stood up on the pedestal in the attitude of a demonstrative lecturer and said, running in his finger along some of the carved decorations around the horse's neck, speaking slowly and uttering his words syllable by syllable, "I could give a sales talk for this better than anyone else. This is a marvelous combination of yellow and indigo, though faded now. How do you people of this country achieve these flaming colors. Muni now assured that the subject was still the horse and not the dead body, said, "This is our guardian. It means death to our adversaries. At the end of Kali Yuga, this world and all other worlds will be destroyed, and the Redeemer will come in the shape of a horse called Kalki. This horse will come to life and gallop and trample down all bad men." While he was brooding on his pleasant vision, the foreigner utilized the pause to say, "I assure you that this will have the best home in the USA. I'll push away the bookcase. You know I love books and I'm a member of 5 book clubs, and the choice and bonus volumes mount up to a pile really in our living room, as high as this horse itself. But they'll have to go. Ruth may disapprove, but I'll convince." Muni continued his description of the end of the world. Now, Muni belonged to a lower caste, children. He had never gone to school, and of course in India, if you see that we have the caste system, Brahmins, Shudras, Kshatriyas and Vaishyas, Brahmins were allowed to attain education. So people like Muni would be debarred of receiving any education. So he used to harvest and he used to plow the fields. And when Pongal used to come, and Pongal is a festival in Tamil Nadu, they had to cut the harvest. His father would allow him to go out and play with the others at the tank. So he says, "I do not know the Parangi language, which is spoken by the foreigner." He wanted to mean that I do not know the Firangi language, which was spoken by the foreigner. "But here only learned men and officers know it." The foreigner laughed heartily and he actually gave him the smoke and the cigarette to smoke. Muni was feeling a lot at ease because he was getting this supply of cigarettes, and he was feeling ease, being very much at ease. Now this foreigner stood up on the pedestal as if trying to demonstrate something, and he raised his hand and he put his hand on the carvings of that particular horse. He said, "I could give a sales talk for this better than anything else," because he was too overawed and too he was feeling very good looking at the statue and its the way it was made. Okay, he liked the flaming colors of the statue, and he explained it bit by bit. Muni was assured that the talk was about the horse and the warrior and not about the dead body. So he started talking about the horse, and he started describing about the horse and the warrior. And about the warrior, he said that this is our guardian and he actually saves us from all the adversaries. And he started explaining as to what had been actually explained to him by the priest of the village, that at the end of the Kali Yuga, when the world will be destroyed, all the bad men will be killed, and this warrior is going to actually save all the good people, and all the bad people will be killed by this warrior on the horse. So the foreigner was brooding on his vision, of taking this horse and the pedestal and the warrior back to USA. He says it will get a very good place in USA, wherein at my place. He was a lover of books. So he said that I had a bookshelf, but I am ready to actually shift that bookshelf, which will be disapproved by his wife Ruth. But he said that he would be willing to do that, and he would be willing to place this horse with the pedestal on the pedestal and the warrior in that room where he would keep his books. Children, let's read further. On page number 63, a pandit discoursed at the temple once how the oceans are going to close over the earth in a huge wave and swallow us. This horse will grow bigger than the biggest wave and carry on its back only the good people and kick into the floods the evil ones. Plenty of them about, he said reflectively. Do you know when it is going to happen? He asked. The foreigner now understood by the tone of the other that a question was being asked, and said, I'm not a millionaire, but a modest businessman. My trade is coffee. Amidst all this wilderness of obscure sound, Muni caught the word coffee and said, if you want to drink coffee, drive further up in the next town. They have Friday market and there they open coffee hotels. So I learn from passerbys. The foreigner said, I repeat, I'm not a millionaire. Ours is a modest business. After all, we cannot afford to buy more than 60 minutes of TV time in a month, which works out to 2 minutes a day. That's all. Although in the course of time, we will maybe sponsor a 1-hour show regularly if our sales graph continues to go up. Then the visitor, feeling that he had spent too much time already, said, "Tell me, will you accept 100 rupees or not for the horse? I would love to take the whiskered soldier also, but no space for him this year. I'll have to cancel my air ticket and take a boat home. I suppose Ruth can go by air if she likes, but I will go with the horse and keep him in my cabin all the way if necessary." And he smiled at the picture of himself voyaging across the seas, hugging the horse. He added, "I'll have to pad it with straw so that it doesn't break. I have my station wagon. As you see, I can push the seat back and take the horse in it if you will just lend me a hand with it." Muni continued his description about the Kali Yuga and how the horse is going to actually come into being a savior of the people, good people, and would swallow and gallop all the bad people from this earth. He described that his Pandit had actually at the temple discoursed once that how the oceans are going to close over the earth in huge wave and swallow everything. The horse will grow bigger and bigger, and people who are good will actually sit on the back of the horse, and the good people are going to be saved, and the evil ones are going to actually be drowned in the floods. Plenty of them, of course, will be drowned in the floods. The foreigner now understood that he had actually been talking about something which he could not understand. He now understood by the tone of the other person that a question was being asked. At least he was able to understand with the tone that he had asked a question. "Do you know when it's going to happen?" when the old man asked him. So the foreigner replied that he's not a millionaire, he's just a modest businessman, and his trade is coffee. And he says that when he said coffee, Muni actually caught that word coffee, and he replied in his Tamilian tone. He said, "If you want to drink coffee, you need to go to the next town. Okay, we have this Friday market, and there are coffee hotels where he could be served coffee." So again, Muni misunderstood what the foreigner was trying to actually convey. So the foreigner repeated the same thing, that he's not a millionaire, he's a modest businessman, and he doesn't get to actually watch TV for more than even 2 minutes a day. And then the visitor was feeling at that point in time that it was too much of time that he had spent over there. So he again offered Muni if he would accept 100 rupees for the horse, because he said that he wanted to take the warrior also along, but then he would not be able to because they do not have space at their place. So he says, "I'll be going by boat. I'll have to actually cancel my air ticket. I'll be going by boat and I'll carry this horse." And he said that Ruth can go by air later on. His wife would go by air. And he smiled and at the picture. He actually was smiling, and he was foreseeing this thing to happen. This thing happening where he's carrying this horse on the boat, hugging that horse, and he's taking it back to his home. So he says, "I have my station wagon, as you see." Then he pointed at his station wagon. He said, "If you could please help me push the seat back, and I'll push the seat back if you could please help me and lend your hand in picking up this horse. It's heavy, and put it on my car." Let's read further. "Lend me a hand and I can lift off the horse from its pedestal after picking out the cement at the joints. We can do anything if we have a basis of understanding." At this state, the mutual mystification was complete, and there was no need even to carry on a guessing game at the meaning of the words. The old man chatted away in a spirit of balancing of the credits and debits of the controversial exchange, and said in order to be on the credit side, "Oh, honorable one, I hope God has blessed you with numerous progeny. I say this because you seem to be a good man, willing to stay beside an old man and talk to him while all day. I have none to talk to except when somebody stops by to ask for a piece of tobacco. But I seldom have it. Tobacco is not what I used to. It used to be at one time, and I have given up chewing. I cannot afford it nowadays." Noting the other's interest in his speech, Muni felt encouraged to ask, "How many children have you?" With appropriate gestures with his hands, realizing that a question was being asked, the red man replied, "I said 100, which encouraged Muni to go into details. "How many of your children are boys and how many girls? Where are they? Is your daughter married? Is it difficult to find a son-in-law in your country also?" In answer to these questions, the red man dashed his hand onto his pocket and brought forth his wallet in order to take immediate advantage of the bearish trend in the market. He flourished a 100 rupee currency note and said, "Well, this is what I meant." The old man now realized that some financial element was entering their talk. He peered closely at the currency note, the like of which he had never seen in his life. He knew the 5 and the 10 by their colors, although always in other people's hands, while his own earning at any time was in coppers and nickels. So children, the foreigner was trying to actually ask the old man to lend him his hand so that he could pick the horse from the pedestal. He wanted it to be detached because there was a cement at the joints. So at this thing, Muni was able to understand that this man is a nice man, is an honorable one. So he said that you are an honorable man, and he said that you might be blessed with a lot of progeny, as such means the children, if you're a blessed man. He says this because he seems that man is a good man, willing to stay beside an old man and talk to him, because he's always had a past where he had even not been given the ear to talk. Okay, so he has never been actually been given the time to talk when people have never stood by him and talked to him. So this was the first time there was this man who was talking at length with him, though they did not understand each other. So he says, I cannot even afford tobacco. And he offered, and he was even amazed, and he was even feeling good about the fact that the foreigner had offered him cigarette. Okay, so he checked out about his children as to how many children he had. So when he asked this question, and the foreigner again misunderstood, he thought that the man was asking for the cost of the horse as to how much he could pay. He said 100. So the Muni actually replied as to how many girls and boys they were, and if the daughters could get married, if the daughters were married over there, was it easier to find the son-in-laws in their country? So all this actually led to humor. Why? Because there are two people with different cultures and their different languages, and they're not able to understand each other. They are poles apart in terms of their understanding to each other, and they are just speaking, and they are just beating around the bush, talking to each other. In answer to these questions, the red man actually dashed his hand out of the pocket, and into the pocket, and he took out his purse from which he actually took out a 100 rupee note, handed it over to him. The old man understood that there was some financial element involved in their talk. And he looked at the note very carefully because he had seen this note for the first time. Imagine the kind of poverty he had faced. He had never seen a 100 rupee note in his life. He had always actually dealt with 5 and 10 rupee notes, and that too, he had seen them. He could actually recognize them with their colors, but then it was the first time that he was looking at something which was so huge. He had always dealt in copper and nickels. Okay, so, and he was amazed as to why the man was flourishing the note at him. So let's read further, children. He was amazed as to why the man was flourishing the note at him, perhaps asking for change. He laughed to himself at the notion of anyone coming to him for changing a 1,000 or a 10,000 rupee note. He said with a grin, "Ask our village headman, who is also a money lender. He can change even a lakh of rupees in gold sovereigns if you prefer in that way. He thinks nobody knows, but dig the floor of his puja room and your head will reel at the sight of the hoard." The man disguises himself in rags just to mislead the public. Talk to the headman yourself, because he goes mad at the sight of me. Someone took away his pumpkins in with the creeper, and he, for some reason, thinks it was me and my goats. That's why I never let my goats be seen anywhere near the farms. His eyes traveled to his goats, nosing about, attempting to wrest nutrition from the minute greenery peeping out of the rock and dry earth. The foreigner followed his look and decided that it would be a sound policy to show an interest in old man's pets. He went up casually to them and stroked their backs with every show of courteous attention. Now the truth dawned on the old man. His dream of lifetime was about to be realized. He understood that the red man was actually making an offer for the goats. He had reared them up in the hope of selling them someday, and with the capital, opening a small shop on this very spot. Sitting here watching towards the hills, he had often dreamt how he would put up a thatched roof here, spread a gunny sack out on the ground, and display on it fried nuts, colored sweets, and green coconut for the thirsty and famished wayfarers on the highway, which was sometimes very busy. The animals were not prize ones for a cattle show, but he had spent his occasional savings to provide them some fancy diet now and then, and they did not look too bad. While he was reflecting thus, the red man shook his hand and left on his palms 100 rupees in tense now, suddenly realizing that this was what the old man was asking. The old man was not able to make out as to why the foreigner was flourishing the note, 100 rupee note, at him. So he laughed at himself as to why somebody would actually flourish that the note of such a big amount at him, because he had always been poor and he had never seen the note of that denomination. So he said, if you want a change, he actually misunderstood and he thought that he was asking for the change. He said, you need the change for this. You need to go to the village headman. And he started about the village headman, how he thinks nobody knows that he had dug the floor of his puja room and he had actually kept a lot of money and gold in it. So he started talking ill of the headman who had hoarded a lot of money and gold in his puja room. So he started, when he was talking about it, he said that the headman would not let, does not like the old man, and he actually started talking about the past where the old man was taken as a culprit. For the headman had lost his pumpkins from his fields, and the old man and his goats were blamed for that. He said that since then, the headman did not like the old man. So, and then he when he was talking about the goats, he said, my goats, there was this blame on my goats that they ate up the pumpkin of the headman. He pointed towards the goats. And now at this, the foreigner thought it wise to actually reach out to the goats and pat them on their back, to showcase a nice gesture to the old man so that he accepts the offer of the selling of the horse. So he patted on the goats, and the old man again misunderstood. And he thought that the red man was trying to actually offer price this 100 rupee note for the goats. And it seemed to the old man that his long-lasting dream, the lifetime dream, was going to be realized. He understood that the man was asking for the goats, and he was offering 100 rupees for that. He had always kept in his mind that he wanted to sell off these goats, and he had dreamt that he would put up a thatch roof on the highway. He would actually keep a gunny sack out on the ground and display his products like fried nuts, colored sweets, and green coconut for the thirsty and the famished passerbys of the highway. This highway was pretty much a busy highway, and he thought that he will be able to run his business over there. So then the animals were not the prized ones. They were not very good looking animals, like the goats were not very healthy. But then at times he had actually given them good nourishment, because he always fancied that one day he will have to sell them, and of course will be able to earn the money by selling these goats. Let's read further on page number 66. Now this man actually left on his palm, the foreigner left on the old man's palm 100 rupees in tens now, suddenly realizing that this was what the old man was asking for. So the foreigner said, it is all for you, and you may share it if you have a partner. The old man pointed at the station wagon and asked, are you carrying them off in that? Yes, of course, said the other, understanding the transportation part of it. The old man said, this will be their first ride in a motor car. Carry them off after I get out of sight, otherwise they will never follow you, but only me, even if I am traveling onto the path of Yam Lok. He laughed at his own joke, brought his palm together in a salute, turned round and went off, and was soon out of the sight beyond a clump of thicket. The red man looked at the goats grazing peacefully, perched on the pedestal of the horse, as the wrestly sun touched off the ancient faded colors of the statue with a fresh splendor. He ruminated. He must be gone to fetch some help, I suppose, and settled down to wait. When a truck came downhill, he stopped it and got the help of a couple of men to detach the horse from its pedestal and place it in its station wagon. He gave them 5 rupees each, and for a further payment, they shipped off the gas from the truck and helped him to start his engine. Muni hurried homeward with the cash securely tucked away at his waist in his dhoti. He shut the street door and stole up softly to his wife as she squatted before the lit oven, wondering if by a miracle food would drop from the sky. Muni displayed his fortune for the day. She snatched the notes from him, counted them by the glow of the fire, and cried, 100 rupees! How did you come by it? Have you been stealing? So children, the old man actually took those notes, the 10 rupee notes of the total of 100 rupees. The old man pointed at the station wagon and he said that, are you going to carry these goats in that? And the other man, actually, with the gesture of the hands of the old man, the foreigner, understood that he's pointing towards the, he's actually talking about the transportation part of the horse. He misunderstood that fact as to what was to be transported. The old man was talking about the goats, and the foreigner was talking about the horse. The old man said this will be their first ride in the motor car, carry them off, okay, when he's gone. So the old man is still talking about the goats, that they are very much attached to me. And if you go, if they have to go to even, if I have to go to even Yamlok, okay, the hell, they will follow me there as well. So he laughed at his own joke and he saluted and he went off. He said, please carry them off when I am gone. The red man looked at the goats grazing peacefully, and he looked at the horse then. And then he actually started thinking probably the old man had gone to get some help to get that horse detached from its pedestal. Okay, so he sat there on the pedestal of that particular horse, waiting for the old man to come back, who would never come back. But by that time, he saw a truck came downhill. He stopped it and he took help of the couple of men who were there on the truck. And they detached that particular horse from the pedestal and put that horse in his station wagon. And this man gave the two truck drivers 5 rupees each. And for the further payment, he actually gave a further payment to them because they helped him with the fuel as well. They filled the gas from the truck to this station wagon so that he could start his engine. Muni, in the meanwhile, he actually hurried homeward. He actually tucked that money in his at his waist, in his dhoti, and he shut the street door and he went softly to his wife, and who had been actually looking up in the sky as if some money or some food is going to drop from the sky. Muni displayed his fortune, his money, 100 rupees, to the lady, and the lady snatched that money from Muni, and under the glow of the fire, she started counting that money, and she was amazed. She was astonished. She said, 100 rupees. How did he get that money, that much of money? She could not believe her eyes, and she thought that Muni had actually stolen that particular money. Children, we read the last of the pages of this short story, A Horse and Two Goats. I had sold our goats to a red-faced man. He was absolutely crazy to have them, gave me all this money and carried them off in his motor car. Hardly had these words left his lips when they heard bleating outside. She opened the door and saw the two goats at her door. Here they are, she said. What's the meaning of all this? He muttered a great curse and seized one of the goats by its ears and shouted, where is that man? Don't you know you are his? Why did you come back? The goat only wriggled in his grip. He asked the same question of the other two. The goat shook itself off. His wife glared at him and declared, if you have thieved, the police will come tonight and break your bones. Don't involve me. I'll go away to my parents. So children, Muni's wife was not able to believe as to how he could procure 100 rupees altogether. And she thought that this man had stolen that money from somewhere. Wherein the old man tried to explain to his wife that he had sold those goats to a red man, and that red man was readily accepted those goats in lieu of the money which he gave him, and that's what he has brought back home. So hardly had he spoken those words when he heard the sounds of the goats outside his hut. The lady went out, the wife went out, she saw the two goats and she was amazed. Because as per the story of Muni, the goats had been sold off to the foreigner, and the goats were outside her hut. She was not able to understand, so she checked out with the old man as to what was the meaning of all that. So he muttered curse onto the goats. He went to the goats. He actually pulled the ears of the goats. The goats would not, of course, reply. The goat shook itself off. His wife glared at him, and of course she declared, she understood that this man had been telling a lie. So she even warned him. She said that if you have thieved and if the police comes in to take him, then she would not support him in any manner and she would go to her parents. So children, this is the way the story ends. The story ends in an utter confusion. We have understood that there is this language barrier, and this language barrier actually leads to so much of confusion in the lives. right? So in my next video, children, I am going to do the theme, the title, justification, the critical analysis of this story. Till then, goodbye. Thank you. Have a nice day. Stay safe.